And so you come back to Los Angeles, where we did, where we kind of sort of lived, and you want to find out what's been going on in your absence. And so after 150 days on the road, you come back and you hang out somewhere where everyone congregates. It's like, what's been going on? What had been going on in those days was not good news. You found out that people had died since you had been away. There's no email, there's no cell phone, so information will sit dormant for months until you come back and poke it and it explodes to life. And so people had died. I said, whoa, wait, how can we be dying? We're young, we're sleek, we're pissed off, we're perfect, we're moving too fast. How can anything kill us? Bullets, lightning, nothing can kill us. What was killing people I knew in Los Angeles was heroin. And I'm kind of sort of a naive bit of a Boy Scout. Drugs are never my thing, really. And so I said, heroin? People really do heroin? I thought it was like some mythical substance in the French Connection film. And like, even if there was heroin, how do you get heroin? I mean, where do they sell heroin? Is it really a gun? I've got heroin. I'm like, is it really something like that? I just didn't know. I knew, but I didn't really believe it. Or I believed it, but I didn't think it would ever be us. So I said, you all do heroin? And I thought in those days, heroin was really expensive. And it was a long time ago. It would come in from Asia, the China White, as they sometimes called it. And apparently it was a rich person's game. But heroin started coming into Los Angeles up from South America, through Mexico, into Southern California, and you know, all over America. And it was the brown heroin, and apparently very, very strong and incredibly cheap. And people were buying their normal bag of weed or wherever they were going, and people were getting three doses of heroin. Like, here's a balloon of heroin, try it. Like, are you kidding? Heroin? Yeah! I don't have a needle. I don't need a needle. Just smoke it. You know, just like, you know, just do some heroin. Check it out. And, you know, like, sit still. You'll vomit at first, but you'll really like it. And all of a sudden, you find out friends of yours weren't trying out heroin. And they're so casual. Yeah, me and my girlfriend, we did heroin last weekend. You did what? You're insane. You're from Mars. I can't even believe that. You did heroin? Oh, no, you should check it out. No, I should not check it out, actually. I should be the anti-checkout on heroin. They go, yeah, we've been doing it every night this week because you're a heroin addict. They go, no, we're not like a junkie. We're just doing it a lot because it's so cheap. And my friend, he's been on it for a month. I mean, he's not addicted. He's got total control of it. And I was like, no, you're a heroin addict. They get angry. What are you, a Boy Scout? You're better than everyone. I said, I'm not better than anybody. I'm just telling you what you are, man. You're a junkie. You have a heroin problem. No, I don't. Then if you don't stop right now, don't do heroin tonight. You shut up. I go, fine, I'll shut up. But you're a junkie. And then you go on tour and come back, that guy had died. And then you come back from tour and like two other people had died. And I'm not conspiracy theory boy, but I think I'm onto something. And I think I was right about what I thought as a 23-year-old. That was a numbskull for a 23-year-old. But I thought, someone's trying to kill us off. And my life became like the opening stanzas of Allen Ginsberg's poem, Howl, where he talks about the greatest minds of his generation, you know, mad in the streets and dying off. And I said, they're trying to kill us. Someone doesn't like our demographic, and they're flooding this city with cheap heroin. This is to the point where you could get like a gunny sack of dope for like $1.50. Or like you get your omelet at Denny's and they give you a free side of heroin. Like you go to the grocery store, I want to buy some nectarines with some heroin. No, I want any heroin. You have to get the heroin, it comes with the nectarines. And you know, it's like pearling, you know, heroin at your, some heroin, take it home, like, ew! And it seems to me someone in the power structure, and I'm not saying, you know, the Bilderbergs, I'm just saying, somewhere up the food chain, they looked at us and they said, no, it's not gonna work. We're gonna kill you off. We're gonna let you kill yourselves off. So we look like the guys in the white hats, and you'll be the guys in the black hats, face down in a pool of your own cold vomit, dead. And we'll say, punk rockers, what do they do? They love anarchy, they love communism, they're non-informative good people, they're bad, they're ne'er-do-well junkies, and the proof, there's another punk rocker, a typical punk rocker, face down in his own vomit. That's what punk rockers do. They buy heroin, they don't contribute to society, and they die off. And it made me furious. And I really thought, someone's trying to kill us off. And I started thinking of that song, If Six Was Nine, from the second Jimi Hendrix Experience album, where he says, like, white-collar conservatives flashing down the street, pointing his plastic finger at me, hoping my kind will drop or die. I'm like, no, you're not gonna get me, man. And it occurred to me that all drugs, you know, the heroin, the crystal methamphetamine, fenciclidine, PCP, at this point, bath salts, ketamine, ecstasy, and all the different versions thereof, It's handed down to us, we, the terrestrial rabble, so we can kill ourselves off. So is racism and homophobia and misogyny. It's more distraction. So you can hate this guy because he's a fag, and that guy's a Jew, and you can't trust these people because they look a certain way, and the president, he's not from here, he's from elsewhere. So we can have this otherness going on. And you can have your job that treats you poorly, you can be in a cubicle that doesn't pay very well. You can't get a living wage, so you have to live like a maniac, live in fear of being foreclosed upon, and so you get very angry. What will give you someone to hate? It's the elite, it's the Jews, it's these guys. It works very well. So you're very, very angry. What do you do to console yourself? You eat bad food. You eat fast food. You eat high fructose corn syrup. You watch stupid television shows. You fill your body with food that clogs up your arteries and turns your blood into syrup. You drink booze. You smoke tobacco. You destroy your body. You become mediocre of aspiration, infinitely arrestable. You don't read. You don't travel. You don't go anywhere. And you're a perfect little product for the man to denigrate and modify and have conform to his house of death. And I'm not trying to, ooh. I'm just saying that for some people, they take it on and they destroy themselves. Someone else is laughing. And you know, somewhere up the power chain or the food chain of all of this, they're laughing. They don't care if Bill marries Tom. They think it's hilarious. Like two fags want to get married. Like we care, we're making money. They don't, Rush Limbaugh can't go to the party with these people. They think he's some stupid idiot who gins up all the morons on the bottom floor. They go, you fat asshole, go get your paycheck and go talk all that stupid shit to all your stupid friends. But you're not eating with us, you moron. Go down there with your dumb friends. Eat bologna. And that would be us down here. It seems to me we should think better. And they want you not to take care of each other. They want you to hate each other and filthify your body. And at 23 years old, when I'm thinking all this, I go, no, it's not going to be me. I'm going to remain angry. I'm going to be like the most pissed off man alive. It's going to be like an anger marathon. And like my hero, Iggy Pop, said in an interview, they said, how do you stay so angry? He said, I work on it, man. But I'm not going to get, you know, killed off by dope or bad food or high fructose corn syrup. I'm moving too fast. There's too much to do. There's too much fun to have. There's too many hands to shake. There's too many, you know, hours of music to dig. And you can't do it if you're trying to destroy yourself. And in my opinion, that's what they handed us. And that was my revelation as a 23-year-old guy. I'm now 51, and I've never got off that train of thought. It informs me to this day. So that's the kind of stuff I was thinking about as I turned 50, eating a tuna fish sandwich in a diner in New York City, but it wouldn't be bad. So,